Good evening and welcome to St. Joseph High School. My name is Bill Fitzgerald. I'm the president of St. Joe's. And we want to welcome to our school. I can't say that we're happy to host an event tonight, but we are glad that you are all with us for an evening with Bishop Caggiano.
Why don't we begin with a prayer, as we always do. In the name of the Father, of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Heavenly Father, we pause this evening to lift our minds and hearts to you in gratitude and in praise. For you are the giver of all good gifts. We especially praise and thank you for the gift of our children, who are our life, who are our love, who are our future. We give you thanks for the gift of our faith, our communities, our parishes, our families, our neighbors. We give you thanks for the gift of Catholic education, which brings us here this evening. It is the divine mission your Son has given us to teach and to preach the good news of salvation. Bless the time we have here together. Help us to work as brothers and sisters, as your sons and daughters, to bring about your kingdom in our midst. And we ask that your blessing come upon us, for we ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
In the name of the Father, the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Before, is anybody out there? Tell them to come on in. Brother Jones, you want to come sit?
No, you don't.
My friends, good evening, everyone, once again. And I want to thank you for taking the time out of probably a very busy and hectic schedule, given particularly the hour, to be here at St. Joseph's High School as we gather to talk about the future of Catholic education, both in Shelton and in Monroe. Dr. Fitzgerald, thank you for your hospitality and for the staff here at St. Joe's for opening up the facility. Tonight, what I'd like to do is give you a fairly detailed presentation of what has brought us to this moment and where we'll be going into the future together. And then there would be time for questions or comments or whatever concerns you may have, initial concerns. There is a lot of information I will share with you. And therefore, there will be other occasions down the road with Dr. Cheeseman and his staff, and perhaps even myself, to be able to continue answering some of these questions in greater detail. Tonight, though, I want to just pause to take the overview and give you the sense of where I believe we need to go to preserve the great gift of Catholic education. There are some basic principles I want to share with you just to begin. First and foremost, every single one of us in this room absolutely is united in the belief that it is all about our children in the end. That everything we're about, everything we do, whether it is natural parents, spiritual parents, it's all about making sure our children have the very best we can give them. And you live your lives as good parents all the time doing that. Just the sacrifices you make to bring them to Catholic school, which is, at many times, a great financial sacrifice. And this process from the very beginning, when it began in 2014, was all about making sure that our children are well cared for. The second is, soon after I came to Bridgeport and we began the strategic planning process, and I will outline, in a sense, how that began and all the steps involved, it became very clear that there were global issues, global challenges that transcended the ability of any particular school in itself to address. And I will give you an example, one that applies particularly in Shelton and Monroe. And that is, there is a decline, a gradual, and now perhaps the indication is an increasing decline in school-age children that are even living in the area, which puts pressure on public schools and certainly is putting pressure on private schools and Catholic schools as well. That's a trend that's beyond any one school to handle on its own. But then there are individual challenges as well. So the process was meant to take both into consideration. The third, and this is something also very important, is as a church, we value history and tradition. In fact, the Catholic Church, as you know, in the secular world, is criticized because we are seen as too much interested in history and tradition. But in this process, it is very important from the beginning, it was very important that we cannot just leap into the future without remembering where we came from and who we are. Most especially, the very venerable traditions that exist in the schools of this area, St. Joseph's, St. Lawrence, and St. Jude's. And the process attempted in many ways, as best as possible, to honor that tradition and to keep it at the forefront of our minds. What I'd like to do with you tonight is the following. First is to look at the process. Where have we come from all of these perhaps last 18 months or more? Talk about some of the data in more particular terms that affect the three schools of this section of the diocese. To talk about the plan that I have approved going forward and how that would affect us, yourselves, children, and everyone who has a portion in this great mission. And then what is next? And the next steps for yourselves and for all that, or for everyone involved in Catholic education. So these are the five parts, and then from there we would open it up for discussion. This is a scanned version of a letter that I trust all of you received on the 16th of December 2015 that was signed by Sister Mary Grace Walsh that announced this planning process. I am not certain that letter got into everyone's hands, but it was created, and it was supposed to be communicated to everyone that this process had already begun. And I must tell you, to the extent that that did not happen, that I am deeply sorry for that. But I am not aware of that having happened until only recently. And therefore, that saddens me, because I very much believe in open and transparent processes, because we are all partners in this great gift. But it was given out because it was a middle piece to a process. So allow me, at the very beginning, 2014 and 15, the very first thing I did was create a diocesan education commission. And its purpose was to look at a strategic plan for the whole diocese, all of the schools, so that we all row in the same direction. So I'll give you an example. To market, so that we would all do a marketing campaign together, rather than have 25 schools try to do it in 25 different ways. That was the intent, and it was formed. But immediately the commission began to realize, when it looked at the data of our schools, that some schools were facing serious challenges in enrollment, in financial stability, and in other issues as well. So the commission asked, and I gave permission for the authorization of what became known as Viability Study 1, looking at all the schools and segregating those schools that were at most and highest risk, where the challenges were severe or grave enough that demanded immediate attention. When that was done, the commission members went to visit those schools, and they visited the remaining schools of our diocese so they could see firsthand the great variety we have amongst all of our schools, and to understand the strengths and challenges of these schools. Then in December of 2015, Sister Mary Grace Walsh issued that letter that I just showed you, saying that now we're moving to a next stage of strategic planning, because now that we know that some of the schools are challenged, and challenged in different ways, now is the time to actually deliberate and make some decisions so that Catholic education could not simply just survive, but could prosper, could become vibrant in every aspect of its life. I personally met with every single school principal of this diocese. I met with the chairs of the boards those who were able to come down to the Catholic Center with all of those chairs of your advisory board, all the advisory boards, to talk about not only the results of this viability study, but also a second level of study and reflection and research to understand clearly what were the challenges that the schools faced. That was when I came on site at St. Joseph's and St. Jude's. And many of the parents who were here from those schools recall the visits I went to do, because those schools were in this Viability 2 cohort of schools, because their attendance and enrollments had begun to fall to the point where it became a significant challenge. And in fact, I came more than once to St. Joseph's and St. Jude's. But now this coming year, 16-17, and my return trip from Krakow at World Youth Day, I thought to myself, if we're going to make any change, any structural change anywhere, we needed to do one last analysis. Because the Viability 1 and 2 looked at the entire school, every aspect of the school, and rightfully so. But when it comes to enrollment, and when it comes to financial stability, like any other institution, we could narrow the study, narrow the analysis to what we call a financial stress test. We needed to get a sense of what ultimately were the financial challenges for all of our elementary schools. Now, I'll give you some of the things we learned. A vast majority of our schools, not all, use next year's tuition to pay this year's bills. And when you do that, you begin to grow a deficit more and more each year. We also discovered what is obvious, that enrollment and financial stability really go hand in hand, because there's only so much parents in their generosity can raise in fundraising. It really is the tuition that is the bedrock of the financial stability of any parent, of any school. So we did this financial stress test, and what we discovered was that St. Joseph's and St. Jude's continue to face the challenges we revealed in the Viability 2, but also there were factors here at St. Lawrence that also began to rise to the level of seriousness. For example, the continuing drop in enrollment, and I'll show you some of those statistics, and the deficit that St. Lawrence is meeting this year. So St. Lawrence on the spectrum is beginning to experience the same struggles that St. Jude and St. Joseph have been experiencing, perhaps in a more severe way, because the trend is moving in the same direction. So all of this was communicated to to school leadership, to the advisory boards. And my hope was, my expectation was, that it would have been communicated to everyone as well throughout the diocese. So I created a planning committee of the region, the three schools, three individuals from each school. Most of them were from advisory boards, but not all, chosen by principals and ratified by the pastors to be able to come together and try to look at these challenges in a more global way. They looked at demographics, enrollment, facilities, finances, and even pedagogy and education to try to get a handle on answering the question. And in the letter I sent in January, you saw the criteria. We want to be able to establish institutions where a parent who has a four-year-old can enter into that school with a reasonable expectation that that child could graduate from that school in the eighth grade. We're looking at long-term stability, not simply short-term stability. That planning committee, I have to speak, many of the members are in this room tonight. And I must tell you, my friends, I have been at educational planning for over 10 years. I created 36 academies in Brooklyn and Queens. This process, I've dealt with hundreds and hundreds of people in this planning process. I have very rarely met a group of individuals as competent, as honest, as transparent, as the group that was assembled to do this project here in Shelton and Monroe. They love their individual schools. That was clear. But they kept their eyes fixed on children first. And they were respectful of each other. They made their disagreements known. But I was extraordinarily impressed and encouraged with the professionalism of this group. And whoever is here who's part of that group, I am very grateful for your sacrifice and hard work to bring us forward to this place. And of course, they made a recommendation. And after the recommendation was received, so that you know fully what happened, I met first with the pastors alone. I met with the principals alone. Then I met with the pastors, the principals, and the planning group as one body. And then I took the data and everything they had recommended, and for about 2 weeks, I reflected on it, I prayed over it, I made a decision, and that is when I wrote to you to invite you to come to this meeting tonight. Now, we are in February. What I'm about to explain to you does still require further planning. So we are now going to pivot to transitional planning to the end of this academic year to prepare for September, and I'll explain what that means in a second. Some of the data so that you're aware. Okay, if you look at the three schools, St. Joseph, St. Jude, and St. Lawrence, all together, 65% of the students in these three schools come from Shelton in varying degrees. You can see here at St. Lawrence, 85% of the students come from Shelton. A few come from Milford, Stratford, Derby, Trumbull, and Seymour. At St. Jude, it's 40% from Monroe, 30% from Shelton, and a whole bunch of other places, Bridgeport, Oxford, Newtown, New Haven. In St. Joseph's and Shelton, 61% of the students are coming from Shelton. They come from Ansonia, Derby, Seymour, from the Valley. So, by and large, this is the composite of where students come from. This is where our students go when they graduate. And the institution in which we are all seated is the prime beneficiary of all the graduates of these three schools. Okay? That's why we're here. St. Lawrence, 53% of the graduates come here to St. Joseph's. And of course, as you know, St. Joseph's is an absolutely superior school. And not because you're sitting here. St. Jude's in Monroe, 36% go to St. Joseph's, but also some go to Laurelton, the prep, public high school. Same thing here at St. Lawrence, 15% go to the prep, 13% to public high school, Laurelton, Notre Dame, Sacred Heart Academy. And at St. Joseph, 32% go to St. Joseph, 28% to public high school, and you can see Sacred Heart Academy, 15%, the prep, Notre Dame and West Haven, et cetera, et cetera. This is the data that was most concerning. You can see the trends in all three schools beginning to drop significantly. The raw data is at the bottom, and quite frankly, I like the raw data better. You can see at St. Joseph's in Shelton, in the academic year 2011 and 12, there were 173 students. There are now 127 students. St. Lawrence, 5 years ago, had 248 students. It now has 170. And St. Jude went from 185 to 80. So the declines are in all three, because part of it is the very demographic change that's going on in the neighborhood, in these two towns of Shelton and Monroe. And quite frankly, the other is the growing inability of families to be able to provide, to pay the tuitions that need to continue gradually to rise just to meet the cost of expenses as they rise. But look at these, 27% over 5 years, 31% over 5 years, 57% over 5 years. And if you consider enrollment driving stability, these are very, very challenging numbers. This is a complicated graph. This will be posted on the website, our diocesan website, and there will be a website I'm going to unveil at the end. This will all be posted. You could study at your leisure. The other thing I want to remind you of, my friends, is this presentation is being taped and will also be posted. So if anyone could not come, they can watch the entire presentation in full. So everyone has the same information. But this basically shows how you have one grade becomes the next grade, the next year, and the next year. And when you have the time at home to look at this, you'll see that the numbers continually, gradually decline, which means the trends are not moving in the right direction. And of course, if enrollment drives stability, you can see this. St. Joseph's has a $177,000 operational deficit. St. Jude has a $250,000 deficit, and this includes a single donation from a single donor of $200,000. This deficit would otherwise be $450,000 just this year. And St. Lawrence has a deficit a little less than $100,000. So when you add it up, it's 526 plus 200 more. It's $726,000 is the operational deficit of the three schools. The diocese will pay this deficit. It is our obligation to do so. And I will gladly do it. The difficulty is, my friends, after accumulating nearly $25 million worth of school debts over the last 15 years, financially speaking, the diocese is coming to the point where we cannot support deficits of this magnitude. The other thing you need to be aware of is, in the creation of a new school, in a merger of schools, the diocese also has to pay the rolling deficit. And what does that mean, so that you're fully aware of what we're talking about? If St. Joseph, St. Jude, or St. Lawrence uses next year's tuition to pay this year's bills, in the creation of a new academy, the diocese will have to pay the difference so that the school begins completely in the black. So the cost for these schools would probably exceed $1 million to catch them. Let's talk about good news. This is good news. These are our Terra Nova scores. And you can see in grade 3, 4, 5, 6, and 7, when you do the composite of the schools, we are above the national averages in almost every respect. So we're all in agreement that the quality of Catholic education is superior. It doesn't mean that we can't do more, and we are planning to do more, which I'll explain in a minute. But I think our teachers do a great job, and quite frankly, our students that mirror the rest of the population do excellently well academically in our schools. So this was the mission statement, if you will, looking at all this data. We have a vision. What's the vision? For a school community living the values of Catholic faith and fostering a personal encounter with Jesus. Let me just stop there. My friends, I've said this to you before, I will say it again. We, all of us here, are here because we want our children not only to learn here, and know the triune God. Know who has created them, who is calling them to holiness, who will one day give them eternal life. We are not private schools. We are Catholic schools. And we will always be Catholic schools. That's why it's first. But our academics should be second to none, period. And infused with cutting-edge technology, high school and university partnership, and differentiated instruction to inspire students to reach their full potential. Natural potential, talents, gifts, knowledge, intellect, and their supernatural potential, holiness in this life, one day, everlasting. And the premise is, and it is a conclusion that from what the data is, one I can, with mixed emotions, that to achieve this vision, to continue the structures the way they are, we can't do this for the long term. for the money that we have to put into the deficits of these schools, imagine what we could do if we put that money into the lives of our children. $500, $600, $700,000 back into the instruction of the schools. That's why this is, in the end, my friends, as difficult as this process is, it is all about our children. So what is our plan? Our plan, first and foremost, is to create a single academy by merging our three schools into one school, into one academy. That academy will be at the campus of St. Lawrence, here in Shelton. And we will do the following. We will, by creating a new school, these are our deliverables. First and foremost, it will allow us to maintain a strong enrollment to support the initiatives and programs that there already exist and that I want to continue to introduce into the new academy. We will take the best of what exists in each of the schools and merge them all together. So programs, extracurriculars, the benefit of one now will be for the benefit of all. The fact that we will have a larger parent community will allow for greater outreach and, please God, more hands to the yoke to be able to move the school forward. We already have the solid foundation of excellence and we can build on that further. We will have more students that allows for greater differentiation of instruction. There will also be new models of instruction, including blending learning, to be developed. Now, I'm going to stop here for a second. I personally believe blended learning model is absolutely at the cutting edge of 21st century education. Blended learning means this: blending online and traditional classroom instruction. More specifically, it can take many variations, but it allows young people online, supervised in a classroom, to develop their gifts and talents, to push them as much as possible, to come to learn as much as they possibly can, as fast as they can. And in the traditional instruction that accompanies that, a teacher would be able to teach the general principles and speak to whatever particular weaknesses, whatever challenges a group of children may have in any given class. So we no longer would have to teach to the middle, and brighter students get bored, and students that have challenges get lost. This sort of structure allows everyone to excel to their maximum potential. Where this model has been introduced, test scores go up 30 and 40% in the first year. Now, I, my friends, am committed to work with you and the leadership of the school to introduce this model into the new academy, starting in the middle school. And as it grows in success, we could discern together how we would expand that further. And this is one of many innovations that are possible as we go forward. And of course, athletics and arts need to be developed because we want a well-rounded student, not simply academic, but we have to also the mind, the arts, etc. So, when I say academy, what do I mean? This is the traditional structure of governance. The three institution schools we have are diocesan schools. The principal is the educational officer, if you will, the leader of the school. And then the teachers and staff are the heart of the school. They are at the front lines of education. But this has a kind of like water goes downhill. So all the major decisions in each of these schools comes out of the chancery, out of Jewett Avenue, because they're diocesan schools. This model, I believe, is missing a major ingredient. And I can explain it to you this way. I do not believe that the chancery is the best place to figure out what is good in Shelton and Monroe, which is different from Bridgeport, which is different from Wilton, which is different from Danbury, which is very different from Greenwich. To assume all that authority in the chancery, I think, is not a model that fits the 21st century. The missing piece is the local leaders of the region, educators, and those who have the time, expertise, and talent to give of themselves to help this school to move forward. That exactly is what the academy governance model is. I want to stop here for a second. Our academies, like the Academy in Bridgeport, has two boards. The first are what we call members. I am a member, and I will be a member. And a member means that we sponsor the school. That means that this school, when it comes to its strategic planning, its Catholic identity, and all the major decisions, including the hiring of a principal, because the principal is both an educator, and a spiritual leader, resides with the members. I am a member, and I will always be a member, and my successor, because the diocese is not abandoning Catholic education. But what it is doing is allowing another group of individuals an opportunity also to share governance, which is the board of directors, made up of lay men and women who will assume the fiduciary responsibility on behalf of the members to run the overall governance of the school. Their job is development, marketing, making sure the facility is in order, and making sure that the school continues to move forward in excellence in every regard. The principal remains the same here as here, as the chief educational, one could say, officer, leader, as well as the chief on-site spiritual leader. And then, of course, you have your teachers and staff, which are the heart of the school, the front lines. This is plural for a reason. Because in Bridgeport, I am the sole member of the Academy of Bridgeport. Here, in Shelton and Monroe, in my conversations with the regional pastors, we are in agreement that the pastors will become co-members with me, so that there will be a link to the parishes through the pastors. And that's part of that tradition I was speaking about, so that we will be, the four of us, will become the members of this new institution. One other thing you need to know. This structure only works very well when this board creates committees and delegates its authority in certain areas to committees. So, finance, academic excellence, school life, Catholic identity are just a few. In this structure, my friends, parents can become members of all those committees. Which means in this model, parents like yourselves, if you have the time and the knowledge and the desire, can actually become part of the decision-making process as it moves its way up. Which is very different from what we have now, where you have advisory boards or a homeschool association, where it is just, we ask opinion. We will still ask lots of opinion, but there's also the possibility of being engaged in decision-making in particular areas of school life. So, that is exactly what I just said. The planning committees, marketing, finance, facilities, development, Catholic identity, academics. We will now begin a strategic planning process for this new academy that will create a 2 or 3 year plan that you will now become partners in as we guide this vision forward, to be able to set benchmarks we're going to achieve every year as we move forward, including the specific initiatives to enhance Catholic education that are already underway, that are still being formulated by the group that began this process by the analysis. I will now look at that group and ask whether those individuals and others are willing to become the first inaugural board of directors. And once I get that commitment, they will now begin the task of starting the strategic planning process. And as I said, one of the items I'm going to put first on the table for them to look at is this blended learning model using integrating technology in academics. What are we looking at for the tuition for this academy? One of the difficulties we had experienced was the great disparity in the tuitions between St. Jude, St. Joseph, and St. Lawrence. So we tried to average them out. So what we came up with was, for one child, the tuition will be $6,000 inclusive of all fees. There are no fees. It's just tuition. There will be a $150 tuition deposit per child. It's not a registration fee. It's a deposit towards the $6,000. It's due at registration, and a full schedule of tuition rates will be distributed. Is there a slide?
There is a slide.
There's a slide, so I'll show you that later on. So we adopted the philosophy, I think it is at St. Jude. Was it at St. Jude? That there were no additional fees. We adopted that philosophy because rather than have a bill here, a bill here, a bill here, it's just one tuition for the whole year. If we have 240 students in this school, which is 150 less than the total, we have about 400 in the three institutions, 240, we will begin to run a surplus. So there is significant possibility of creating true long-term stability in this school. So you'll see there, that is a swing of $550,000 from red to black. My hope is that we would enroll everyone, in which case this number becomes dramatically higher. But for conservative planning purposes, you can see where the threshold is. So what are the strengths that we talked about? All right. First of all, the high school and university partnerships will be now extended to all our children. The partnerships with Sacred Heart University, Fairfield University, and others, St. Joseph's High School. The STEM programs will be expanded for everyone. Use of the technology, the extracurricular activities, whether it's robotics, that's at St. Jude's, will come over to the academy. All the rest, the honor societies, every strength in individual schools will be married into the new academy. Enrichments programs, service opportunities, and the rest. And even this, my friends, we have a number of students who do have particular needs. And we are committed to ensure that anyone who wants their child to come to school, presuming that the need, the special need, is not severe, that we would be able to provide the resources to ensure that child to be able to come to a Catholic school as well. So these are the deliverables that I want to announce to you, because if you're sitting there trying to digest all of this and you say, okay, Bishop, this sounds like, you know, but it's all about people. Tell me something concrete here, except tuition. By March 1st, we will be announcing both the board of directors, and my presumption is that we will have an in-person meeting and you will meet who these people are. They will introduce themselves so you will know who they are. We will also talk about the administrators of the new academy. Now I'm going to stop and I'm going to raise something extraordinarily personal. It is simply this. We have three institutions with dedicated, hardworking, and generous teachers, staff, and leaders. They are the backbone of Catholic education. In creating and merging three schools, there will be fewer positions than we have current staff. So we are committed, we as a diocese are committed to work with the individual teachers and staff so that those who cannot have a place in the academy will be able to, in a very personal and professional and sensitive way, allow them preference to be able to teach elsewhere, because I don't want to lose anyone from our Catholic school system. And therefore, there'll be more discussion about that the superintendent can answer if you have a question, but we have already met with the faculty. We will come back on site to meet with the faculty. It is extremely personal. But I'm committed to make sure they are treated with respect because they deserve it. If they were not for the faculty, we wouldn't even be here. But given the change, we have to make sure that they're cared for. So we have to, and we would like to announce the new faculty, the final roster, once registration is, you know, well underway, by April 1st. Because if there are faculty members who will not be able to have a position in the new academy because we don't have the same amount of class grades, then that is when the process of discerning teachers in other institutions begins in the diocese, so that we will be able to help them to do that. And the rest of that is basically what I explained. Now, here's another sensitive issue. The name of the school. My friends, I've done this 36 times. This is an extraordinarily sensitive topic. Why? Because on one level, we want to respect our history and our tradition. On the other hand, we do not want to create winners and losers, nor do we want to have something imposed from above. For example, I'm only here 3.5 years. But even in 3.5 years, I've come to realize that in Stamford, when Trinity Catholic High School was created, and the name was created, suggested by the diocese, because it was the merger of three schools into one, and therefore Trinity, that has left a deep wound in the lives of many people, because they were not consulted. They didn't have an ability to speak their mind. And that is not the way I operate. So my suggestion, and there was an acceptance, well, of course, it's my suggestion, we're gonna do it, but I mean. is I want our children, and I want you involved in the process. More specifically, there are, you know, it can't be Disneyland school, I mean, or Brianna High, or something like that. But we're gonna explain to the children the norms, and they're very simple. And we're gonna ask them to submit three names each, their favorite names. We're gonna call those all together, and then we'll have the 10 most common nominations will be sent to you as parents. And we want you to pick so that we can get the top three results that will come to me. Canonically, I have to choose the name. But the truth of the matter is, given this process, whatever the top pick is what I will choose. So it becomes the first exercise where we are all working together to create this identity that respects the past, but also recognizes we are giving birth to something new. This is the tuition in its fullness. So if preschool, 3 and 4 year olds, the 3 full days, 5 full days, if you have specific questions, the superintendent can answer that. But you will see here, for example, in the tuition scale, 6, 10, 14, 2, and 17. Now, for the parents who, for example, come from St. Joseph's in Shelton, this represents 600 more than what is being paid now, because it rolls in the fee that was the activities fee. These numbers for St. Lawrence are lower than what's being asked now. But what I want to say to all of you is that everyone who registers for the academy, I urge you to also, through FACTS, apply for the Bishop Scholarship Fund. Because the Bishop Scholarship Fund can be of tremendous assistance to help those who, if you're experiencing a tuition increase, we can help, the fund can help to bridge the gap. Okay. My goal is to allow access for everyone who would want to come to be able to come. But this was a really valiant attempt, and I think the committee spent a long time trying to figure out how to bring those tuitions together because they were so different, and allow the finances to work. The registration fee is going to be $150 per student. Now, see this? This is something made up. We had to open up a bank account for a new academy. This is not the name of the school, unless you voted to be the name of the school. Because we want to keep this money completely segregated from the three institutions. So we start on the right foot. But once we name it, then of course we'll switch the name. So now, we have packets for you. This is a tremendous amount of information, I know. We have packets for you to take home. A lot of this information is there, including a registration form that's generic, that puts all of this here. This, my friends, are diocesan deadlines. They're true for all the schools. All the schools began re-registration in Catholic Schools Week, which is this week, just ending. And we open up to new students on February 15th. So I don't want you to worry too much about these dates, because these are diocesan dates. But this is important, because as soon as you feel comfortable to be able to say, yes, I'm going to register my child in this academy, and I please God, you all will do that, then the Bishop Scholarship Fund, once you register, I would ask you to go apply for the Bishop Scholarship Fund. And the Bishop Scholarship Fund gives out its aid in different deadlines. April, June, I forget now what the third word is. Pat, where are you? Holly, come in for a second. What are the three? Holly is the Executive Director of Foundations and Education and administers the Bishop Scholarship Fund. What are the dates, Holly?
The deadlines are April 30th, and then you can give them around in June, and then of final round in August.
So the monies are awarded at the end of April, the end of June, and the end of August. But the truth is, the hope is that by the end of April, the vast majority of the awards are given out. So, there is a website here, ournewschool2017.com. This presentation is on this website. All this PowerPoint is on this website. All the tuition information on this website. The packet, if you wish to take it, which I hope you do, is all on this website. There is one other thing, too. There is this number you can call. If you have a question, don't call it once, okay? But if you have a question about tuition, whatever, this number is manned by staff in the superintendent's office. And they are at your disposal to answer your questions one person at a time. Or the website, too, has tremendous information on it. So that is basically the presentation.